I think my artistic practice must be defined by the concept of variety, not the least. Since I have made experiments in different fields of music theatre, yes, it's very hard to describe. It's but let's say that in my artistic practice, each work is a project in itself, delving as deep as possible into a certain argument. So in that meaning, I would say that each work is a separate is a research in itself. I think I would not be able to find a big continuity it's not like I just found one approach to creating art and then I continued in that direction, although there may be short sequences of works in the same researching the same argument in a way. But mostly I would say that I am each time approaching a new project, a new thing I want to discover in what I'm doing. From a very early age, I had much more experience with writing texts. In fact, I did publish a book of poetry at a certain point, at a young age. And I've been very taken by prosody and metrics, having written also articles on that topic. So poetic studies have been part of my output in a way. So that is one element. I do recall, yeah, well, perhaps you are looking for something that defines my present activity as cross arts. Mm-hmm. More so I won't be going through my whole the story of my life.
Currently,
yes, currently, of course, my work in music theatre would definitely place me as a practitioner of cross arts. I have written three sort of operas or music theatre productions that have been staged in Gothenburg with and also in Iceland and in Oslo. But the approach in those cases is always quite cross-arts in the sense that incorporate in the concept of the pieces has been a certain concept of direction, stage direction. Much of the composition itself has to do with stage action and movement on stage, and also we are into acting here, because I tend to extend my techniques, which originally I have developed just for making music. I tend to extend them to the use of the voice, the directions for the actor, placements on stage, etc. I have been in collaboration with the Swedish director Svante Aulis Löwenborg for these three productions, but the third production, an opera based on the Icelandic saga, Njáls saga, in that case I eventually took over the stage direction, so I was also in the role of director. So that gives an idea sort of cross.
Can you give an example of the extension of your composition technique into movement on stage, for example?
Yes, definitely. The work, which the most recent music theatre work, Njáls saga, is based on certain patterns, note patterns, melodic patterns, if you like, but they can very easily be translated into movements. As an example, I'll give two examples. The first scene of this work is the so-called knife aria. So it's almost a silent part where there is a, originally it was supposed to be a spear, but we did a version where a knife is moving through space in a definite pattern. It's and I call it an aria because it's constructed practically like an aria.
Mm-hmm.
So there's very little sound, but you have, I composed the movement in such a way that you could follow it almost for, I think it's like 5 minutes. And if I hadn't composed it, if it was only improvised, I don't think you could have sustained the attention for all that time, I think. In another, in a later scene from that same piece, I did use the same patterns to devise movements on stage in a certain, there are four characters, and I composed very precisely a pattern of movement which had certain consequences in how they meet on stage, etc. But two examples of where musical techniques of even a canon technique and polyphonic technique has been extended into movement, into stage action. Yeah, the three works I mentioned have come about through a very close collaboration between me and the director. Also in the third case, between us and the librettist, author of the text. Previously I did do a whole production of stage music for a production of the National Theatre of the Bacchae by Euripides. The question of collaboration, I think the experience I've had has been very useful, and let's say that my main approach is as I explained to Löwenborg, for instance, I do very clear proposals. As, for instance, when you write a score, a musical score, it's really definite, how it looks very definite as a suggestion. But it's very important to make those who are collaborating with me understand that it's just a proposal. It's something you have to work on and find don't want to call it compromises, but different new versions. It's a sort of a, it has to go through different stages. So let's say a key word for me is having the courage to state your ideas very clearly, just to create an energy, a creative dialectic between you and your collaborators, because I really don't understand, I haven't seen how that can happen, that an idea is created by two persons simultaneously. I always believe there's a back and forth in the process, but of course you have to be very open to that process as a method. Yes, well, it was a sort of a revelation, this thing I mentioned in the earlier reply, that you really have to state your ideas very clearly and be ready to face the consequences, because this is something I developed also in collaboration with Ludwig Ulbors, who was the text author of the text for the latest production, because his proposal for text for our last piece was something impossible to stage. And he was very conscious of that. And I appreciated very much how precise he was about that fact, that writing a libretto or writing a theatrical text, for instance, implied in reality contrasting, creating something that, challenge. So it's a challenge for the others, because if you don't challenge the others, it's not as interesting, and I really appreciate it, even though first when I received his text, I thought he was totally crazy, it was impossible, but that actually brought me to some conclusion. So challenge is a key word for this, and it was a revelation.
Perhaps it can be also referred to also in improvisation, because you are, it's always a proposal from, even though it happens more rapidly, but the challenge, yeah, it's a good.
You are always limiting the possibilities of your counterpart when you're improvising. If I give an idea, I'm always closing down in on you.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have as many possibilities, so I'm challenging you in a way, and
mm-hmm.
you have to work with that, and you will reply.
Exactly. Yeah.
And that's a very interesting how this can happen, and the truth that happens somewhere in between different genres also. I discovered this also, just to add, that was a revelation for me also, when I decided to incorporate a video in a composition, and called Play and Destroy. And the first part of the piece was supposed to be a silent video, and then with music accompanying the video. And I reflected very, very much and deeply on what kind of music should accompany the video, what is the relation. And my conclusion was that there is no relation. There is no one place in the brain where sound and image come together. There's always a counterpoint. And that was very important for me, not to deceive myself that they are the same object in a way. They are always perceived separately, but you have to be very conscious of the counterpoint and how you play with different parameters of
mm-hmm.
the show. But yes, to sort of be clear that despite this, you are, when you work on the counterpoint between, for instance, image and sound, actually what is created is a very interesting thing in between. It's the feeling, it's the electricity between the two. And that is actually a work of art. But it's very, very hard to define what it is.
Mm-hmm.